Welcome to Catholicism Live. I'm Mary Jane Fox.
I'm Deacon Tom Fox. We thank you for joining us here on Catholic Television of San Antonio and Guadalupe Radio Network. We're also streaming live on CatholicismLive.com. This program is produced by the Pilgrim Center of Hope. The Catholic Evangelization Ministry has been serving the Archdiocese since 1993, and our purpose is to take a deeper look at our Catholic faith, to really appreciate this great gift that we've been given so that we will live and share our faith with others.
The Pilgrim Center of Hope is an evangelization apostolate that has been serving since 1993. And one of our ministries under the umbrella of the Pilgrim Center of Hope is that of Ministry of Conferences. Each year, we organize a conference, one Catholic Women's Conference, Catholic Men's Conference, and just recent, last Saturday, a Catholic Seniors Conference that was initiated by Archbishop Gustavo's idea and his concern for the elderly and the seniors in the Archdiocese 3 years ago. So this was the third one, this last Saturday. It was held at St. Matthew Catholic Church Family Center with 300 participants. It was fantastic. It was wonderful. We started with Mass that morning at St. Matthew Church with Father Servando Guerrero from St. Francis of Assisi Parish here in San Antonio, who offered Mass and gave it a really beautiful homily directed to, based on the gospel message, yes, but also directed to the senior community. Linking the gospel message to the senior community was so unique in the way he delivered that beautiful message during Mass. And the church was filled. It was just beautiful. The ushers and those who served during the liturgy ministers were all seniors. So it was just so refreshing, so beautiful to see such a service with many smiles and anticipation for the conference. So after Mass, we started the conference at the McDonald's Center, and two speakers were involved. That was Father Guerrero from St. Francis of Assisi, who spoke about our journey of life and at different times in our life, what we come across, but how hope is there for us, thanks be to God. And then Susan Tassoni, who from the Archdiocese of Chicago, spoke about purgatory. But you know how she spoke about purgatory is the sense of a hope, a mercy of God. In this year of mercy, she really stressed how we can be have such influence on the church suffering, which is part of the mystical body of Christ, the souls in purgatory.
And how they can have an influence on
and
us.
And how they can help us. Mm-hmm. Well, many of the evaluation forms came back with beautiful comments, positive comments, stating how they were so happy to know that the Catholic Church does need them. Oftentimes, seniors and elderly feel like they've been forgotten by the church. On the contrary, the church is always there for them. And so that was reiterated and certainly stressed at the Catholic Seniors Conference. If you'd like to know more about the Catholic Seniors Conference, visit our website, CatholicismLive.com, which again is under the umbrella of the Pilgrim Center of Hope. And we will have the speaker presentation on the website and an opportunity for you to, if you'd like, to purchase the prayer book that was printed specifically for the senior population, and that prayer book is called the Fountain of Life Prayer Book. So check us out.
Okay. So moving on, recently on this program, we looked at several answers to the question, what does it mean to be Catholic? Largely focusing on the church as a lens through which we see Christ and all the gifts that he's given us and that have been handed down to us and developed over 2,000 years. But tonight we want to really focus on Christ himself and to answer the question, what does it mean to be a Christian and a disciple? And you have an opportunity to join in on the conversation by calling us at 210-734-5371.
And I'm sure you'd want to call in with your questions because our guest is with the Archdiocese of San Antonio. She is Gloria Zapiain, Director of the Secretariat for Catechesis for the Archdiocese of San Antonio. And Gloria, whose many friends call her Gigi, as we do, because Gloria is also a dear friend of ours. We've known her for a long time. And in fact, Gloria, Gigi, has spoken at our Catholic Women's Conference, and she has certainly been very supportive of the evangelization mission of the church, because indeed, catechesis the catechetical office is about evangelization as well, of course. So Gigi is with us today, and we're going to look at this topic of discipleship. And how is it that it can relate, just looking at it a little bit deeper. So Gloria and Gigi, welcome to Catholicism Live.
Thank you, Mary Jane. It's great to be here.
I love that name, Gigi. I think it's just so unique and just so interesting. But so we're glad you're here, Gigi, because you have so much experience and knowledge in traveling, giving presentations, parish missions, workshops to catechists, to individuals, to laity, to parishioners at different levels, and you really have been able to help people discover the richness of our faith, but also discipleship, how to help them become a disciple of Christ.
It's such a basic thing that sometimes we just sort of gloss over it. We think we know what it means, but it's very good sometimes to go back to think, wait a minute, what do I really think about this? So when we talk about discipleship, let's go back a little further. Let's talk about what is discipleship about. Well, disciple, of course, comes from the same root as discipline. Mm-hmm. It is something that requires effort. It is something that actually costs something. We must, you know, apply ourselves to be disciples. Discipleship implies that we have to apply ourselves. So to what are we applying ourselves to? What kind of effort are we making? Well, when Christians talk about discipleship, we talk about the person of Christ. Who is Christ and why should we bother, right? It has been said that Christ was either a liar or he was truthful. And we must decide, everyone must decide who Christ is. Was one of the questions that he asked his own followers, who do you say that I am, right? So that's a question that all of us must answer. Was he truthful about what he had to say about himself, about what he represented, about who his father was, or was he a charlatan, or was he crazy? And all of us must look at what he himself has said in the scriptures, what the witnesses to what he has said have told us, and come to a decision. Now, discipleship is something that doesn't happen once. Discipleship isn't a decision as much as it is a way of life. Now, for Christians, Catholics among them, discipleship begins at baptism. At baptism, we receive the grace to be able to live a life of discipleship. We receive the graces, the infused faith, hope, and love, those wonderful theological virtues, to be able to live out this calling, this discipleship, which requires direction and effort. And discipleship is not something that one does alone. There are others who are disciples. And discipleship, we learn discipleship from others, from seeing other disciples, from actually living and praying with other disciples to know what it is to follow a life of discipleship. So it's a way of life. It is an adherence to the person of Christ and his words and his teachings. And it's also something we witness to. Witness is another term that we use, that we on a regular basis hear about. But what does that mean? And what's the difference between witness and discipleship? Exactly. Often we hear it used interchangeably. Mm-hmm. Witness could be good witness. It's example, all right? What kind of an example do we give? Now, parents know that children do what they see their parents do more than they do what their parents say. So parents know that their witness, a good witness, is important if they want to pass on their values that they want their children to emulate. They know their witness is important. And for Christians, if we want to be authentic disciples, our example, our witness as Christians must also be authentic. If we want to show the world what it is to be a Christian, our witness must be authentic to Christianity. We must not give what is sometimes called contrary witness. Contrary witness is to give, to live in such a way or to give an example that is contrary to the Christian faith. So I would say that to be a witness is a part of discipleship. Discipleship encompasses the entire way of life, and witness is part of that.
Mm-hmm. You know, just as you're speaking, and I've never even given a thought to this before, but, you know, Christ said we are to be a light to the world this assault, you know, this, and it's just like, this may be not theologically correct, but to be a witness is more like the light, and to be a disciple is more like the salt, because the salt changes what it is, you know, what it, whatever you put it in, that it, sure, that it causes, you know, it causes a, you know, something different. And, you know, that may be way off base, but for somehow that just struck me as you were speaking. We're called to be both salt and light. We don't have a choice. It's that we have to be proactive, and we have to be, as you said, you know, a witness.
Indeed, indeed. And since we know that discipleship requires effort, that it is something that really calls something from us, it's not something that's automatic necessarily, and it's not always an easy thing. And one of the things that we struggle with, I think, as Christians in the 21st century, is to be able to live that kind of authenticity. I think for several reasons. A very well-known author, Sherry Waddell, has spoken about intentional discipleship. The terminology that she uses is to be an authentic disciple as a baptized Christian takes 5 deliberate steps. And this is something that, you know, we all waver. It's not one thing that happens after another necessarily, or sometimes we could backtrack. But I think these 5 steps, I think, are very instructive to us as we endeavor to be authentic disciples, as we endeavor to give true witness to our faith. First, she says, anyone must have an initial trust. We learn who God is from the first witnesses, who usually are, if we grew up in a Christian family, our parents, or if we don't, to the first Christians that we meet. Who are they? Can we trust who they are, what they have to say? That before faith comes in, we must have an initial trust in those who call themselves Christians. This is why authentic witness is so important. Then, she says, a spiritual curiosity must take place. Very often, this is the result of a movement of grace that takes place when there's trust established, when someone hears some Christian friends talk about an event, a church service or a mission trip or some kind of an event, and they're curious about it, or they're curious about a service or a mass or a liturgy that they may be attending. This isn't conversion yet, but this is just a wondering. After that is called, she describes a spiritual openness. it moves from curiosity to a desire to experience some of these. Someone who maybe isn't ready to join the church, but might want to tag along to Mass or to be part of a team that goes to a soup kitchen every third Thursday of the month. And that is how witness of other Christians and their spiritual curiosity can be fed. Mm-hmm. And only after that time, when trust, curiosity, and the openness takes place, does one become a spiritual seeker, someone who actually actively is looking for who Christ might be. And after, at that point, one then is ready to invite somebody to participate more fully in the Christian life. For Catholics, that would mean inviting somebody to the catechumenate, to the RCIA, or something similar. And only then is one really prepared to be what Sherry calls an intentional disciple, an integral witness to the faith.
I'm jumping in a bit more. This is very good, Gigi. This is interesting because oftentimes people do ask those kind of questions and they realize, how is it that I can help someone who is searching or seeking, and understanding that a bit more clear as you're explaining
begin
it
the journey.
Really begins, helps us understand the journey, which is often a term that's used quite a bit in the church in this kind of look at discipleship. Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll continue to talk about discipleship and the basis of Christianity and who is Jesus and what is the difference between witness and discipleship. We'll continue to look at that a bit more. Our phone number is 210-734-5371. Our guest, Gloria Zapiain. She is with the Office of the Secretariat for the Catechesis for the Archdiocese of San Antonio. We know her by Gigi, as many of her friends do. Stay with us. We'll be right back on Catholicism Live, and we'll be waiting for your questions as well. Thank you. Right back. Welcome back to Catholicism Live. I'm Mary Jane Fox with my husband, Deacon Tom Fox, and our guest, Gloria Zapiain. She's with the Archdiocese of San Antonio, the Catechetical Office. We're very happy she's joined us because we're looking at a topic that is really very interesting, and thinking about our faith, especially during the season of Lent. People often start pondering and seeking to understand more who they are as a Christian, as a disciple. How do I witness my faith? How do I live my faith and share it with others? And that's, even though we have been cradle Catholics or people who have been very involved with church, sometimes it can be a little uncomfortable. And so Gigi is really, as we say, Gloria, we call her Gigi. We're asking her to shed light, to have us look at this journey, this method, this process of how a person can enter into discipleship with Christ.
Well, I think something that I feel is important, you know, Jesus, when he speaks about discipleship, he said, you must deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. You, like you mentioned, it's not necessarily an easy journey. It's the right journey. It's the journey that fulfills our life. But all of us have things that in our life that are inconsistent with witness or discipleship. We have to recognize those things and deny ourselves of those things that may be pleasurable. There may be things that have been a part of our life for a long time, but Christ said, no, actually...
My grace is enough for you.
Yes,
right.
And it's
very
actually, we can only be his disciple with his grace, that discipleship mm-hmm. will call us out of our comfort zone. We can't just do to be comfortable. That's because when it's outside of our comfort zone, then we know it's his grace that's working, if there's something fruitful.
Us. Yes. Indeed. And Tom, particularly now in the 21st century, millennials, Gen Xers, Gen Yers, we hear a lot about commitment phobia. We know that there are whole generations that are reluctant to make commitments of all kinds. And that includes a commitment to any kind of lived faith, to any denomination. And so understanding, I think, the steps or the stages of discipleship, I think, are very important. Mm-hmm. Because we have to help people who see something in others, see something in someone who lives the Christian life. We must be careful to nurture and fan that flame, not to drown it out with too much too soon. Yeah. Particularly because we have this interplay of, well, I'm interested, but you know, I'm not sure, I have to be open to, I can't commit kind of thing. So the trust factor from Christians is critical to begin with. We know that in our technological age, I remember being quite shocked that even when I lived in Washington, D.C., I had to renew my passport. I called the passport office and I was on the phone for more than 30 minutes and was transferred by machine to at least six or seven other answering devices. And I hung up the phone and I thought, if this is what life is coming to, I might move to a mountaintop in Peru. People are looking for authenticity, yes, particularly in relationships and interactions with others, even if you're applying for just a passport. Trust, spiritual curiosity, to feed that and not drown it out, to help someone move, with God's grace, of course, to a spiritual openness where one can introduce them to experiences, to TV shows, to radio programs where they can sort of drink in and understand more at their own pace, to where we can pray for them, mm-hmm, and even pray with them when they become spiritual seekers through the grace of God.
And I think what you're saying, Gigi, reminds me of what Pope Francis is reminding us, especially during this year of mercy. You know, to the corporal and spiritual works of mercy, it's to be present.
Yes.
The whole ministry of, well, it's beyond a ministry. It's what we need, is what we're called to be as a human person, to be present to the other. But because, yes, of our fast-paced world and schedules and demands and those devices that answer our phone calls, and we get frustrated and we think, where is the reality? Where is the human touch? Mm-hmm. And I think going back to the authenticity, and Pope Francis is reminding us with the Year of Mercy and reminding us to be present, to accept the other,
yes, worthy,
or to see the other,
yes,
as they are, and walk with them. I think what you said was so beautiful because, Gigi, so often we're so fervent in our faith. Maybe we just got off a retreat experience, or we just learned about something, we just read a book, and we just want to help the whole world to read the same book, mm-hmm, or to have the same experience. And good, that's good to have that kind of fervent faith and excitement and zeal. But that's where we invite the Holy Spirit to be our coach. I always call him my coach because, boy,
yes,
I need him to help me to, you know, well, okay, let's just see, let's take a step at a time. Am I going to dump the whole bucket on this person?
That's right.
So I like this explanation. So so going back to what you're saying, Gigi, this, the whole initial trust and curiosity, how about for ourselves? I mean, for us who have been, for people who have been cradle Catholic, or maybe we have just, you know, we've gone to church on Sunday and we're thinking, how can I be a better disciple? Where can I begin now?
We all have to ask ourselves that question. Someone a long time ago said to me, conversion is something that you do every morning when you put your feet on the ground getting out of bed.
Very good.
Conversion is not a one-time event. It is something that we must renew in ourselves on a regular basis. And that's why things like retreats, time to whether whatever we find spiritually renewing, whether it's spiritual reading or time away or time in nature or a combination of those things, whatever feeds the soul, I think is necessary for everyone. And this, all of us need to have our trust renewed. We all must maintain a spiritual curiosity. We can never learn everything there is to know about Christ. We must always remain spiritually open. We must remain open as little children are open if we are to be accepted into the kingdom of God, right?
Right.
And we must always be seekers of Christ. So all of those steps that we talk about for those who